one to share with no one who truly cares for me. Some people want it all, but I don't want nothing at all. But no, if it ain't you, baby, if I ain't got you, baby. Some people want diamond rings, some just want everything, but everything
morning, Dr. Joseph. You may now try sharing your slides.
Yes, that's perfect. I'll try now. Thank you. It says host disabled participant screen sharing.
All right. Sir Dex, kindly make sure po that Sir Joseph can share his screen. Thank you. Can you try again, sir? Thank you. Doc Joseph, can you try, sir, again?
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you. Why is that not here? Oops.
We can see your desktop, sir.
Ah, okay. How about that one?
The PowerPoint is now starting up.
Okay. Shall I just open it as is, open or still close while we are talking, while we are about to start?
You may close it, sir. Thank you.
Sorry, I didn't hear that.
You may close it, sir.
I will close it. Okay.
Okay. You can minimize it, sir. Minimize, sorry.
Minimize. Okay, thank you.
And you may stop sharing in the meantime, sir.
All right. Thank you for the test.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Rainbow, so pretty in the sky, are also on the faces of people passing by. I see friends shaking hands, saying, how do you do? They're really saying, I love you. I see babies cry. Watch them grow. They'll learn much more than I'll ever know. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. Oh, I think to myself, what a wonderful world.
A great Friday morning to everyone. Today is the second and last day of the 5th Environmental and Occupational Health Forum. I am Dr. Paul Michael Hernandez, your Master of Ceremonies for today. On behalf of the Department of Environmental and Occupational Health, College of Public Health, University of the Philippines, Manila, I would like to welcome all of you back for day two of this year's forum with the theme Environmental and Occupational Health towards the promotion of healthy workplaces. We welcome all our guests and colleagues. You are most privileged to bring this fifth offering and incidentally, the third virtual one to all of you. Note that this forum is being live streamed through YouTube. In case you get disconnected and you are unable to reconnect, you may still participate in the forum by visiting our YouTube channel, DEOH UP Manila. To give us the highlights of yesterday's proceedings, let us hear from Mr. Harvey C. Domingo. Let me first share a quick introduction of him. Mr. Domingo is an instructor from the Department of Environmental and Occupational Health. He is a physical therapist by profession and currently a student of the Master of Science in Public Health Biostatistics program of our university. Aside from teaching and research, he also pursues public service activities. Most of these are in the field of biostatistics for public health, as well as advocacy activities of the Philippine Physical Therapy Association. He has served as public relations officer of this organization and pursued special projects for the Filipino Physical Therapists Accredited Professional Organization. Over to you, Sir Harvey.
Thank you very much, Dr. Hernandez. Good morning, everyone, and welcome to day two of our fifth Environmental and Occupational Health Forum. I am honored to share with you the highlights of our first day in the forum. Everyone was welcomed to the forum with a message from our dear UP Manila Chancellor, Dr. Carmencita Padilla, who emphasized that every employer needs to create a safe working environment. Chancellor Padilla proudly shared that our very own institution, UP Manila, is fully committed and very serious in building and sustaining a strong culture of health and safety in the workplace. She highlighted that this year's forum focuses on two confronting issues, defining the post-pandemic workplace and assimilating the best practices of non-health workplaces learned during the pandemic. Chancellor Padilla encouraged us to continue discussing the opportunities and challenges in EOH and to not stop from exploring better ways to prepare. She's glad to have the UP College of Public Health in leading these discussions and collaborations among stakeholders. Afterwards, we were honored to have the UP College of Public Health Dean and Simeotropmed Philippines Regional Center Director, Dr. Fernando Garcia Jr., share his message to everyone. Dean Garcia highlighted that we must always take into account the various workplace factors affecting the health of the workers, as they are key in driving the development of the nation. He emphasized that this forum shall serve as an avenue to discuss strategies and empowering the workforce and promoting better worker health. This forum will also serve as an avenue for collaboration among sectors, which is vital to its success. We thank Chancellor Padilla and Dean Garcia for gracing us on our first day and for sharing your key messages for this forum. The scientific program then started with its first lecture entitled The Workplace as a Healthy Setting. Our speaker, Dr. Hiromasa Okayasu of the World Health Organization Western Pacific Regional Office, highlighted that non-communicable diseases affect the working population, and it causes premature mortality, absenteeism, and presenteeism. The Philippines, further, he said that the Philippines has an increased burden of these NCDs and other chronic conditions. Dr. Okayasu emphasized the significant role of workplaces to improving community health as businesses provide products and services consumed by the population. It is therefore important that we invest in actions and programs against diseases that is and will be affecting the workers. Bad employee health will turn out to be more costly, and so we must see employee health as a sustainable investment. Day one of the fifth EOH Forum also hosted its first panel discussion, which focused on defining what the post-pandemic workplace is. We had three distinguished resource persons who shared the experiences from their respective institutions and countries. Engineer Xiong Hin Ho, President of International Association of Labor Inspection and Senior Director of the Ministry of Manpower in Singapore, discussed the standards of labor inspection before, during, and after the COVID-19 pandemic. Engineer Ho shared that countries who had prior experience of public health emergencies had good emergency plans for the current pandemic. Labor inspection during the pandemic became challenging for countries with no prior experiences, especially since they continue to focus on looking at traditional occupational safety and health issues. Engineer Ho mentioned that since the pandemic has made it difficult to perform labor inspection, it is therefore needed to have redesigned policies that is made collaboratively to respond to the demands of the time and that actions are needed to be localized and contextualized. Next to share in our panel discussion was Mr. Manny Ferrer Arahona, Senior Public Health, Public Quality Health and Safety Inspection Officer from Dubai Municipality of United Arab Emirates. Mr. Arahona shared about the work, environment, and health experiences of Dubai. He shared that there are laws that covers labor practices covering both nationals and expatriates. Additionally, he shared that Dubai implements codes of practices and circulars and technical decisions relating to specific environmental and occupational health issues, supplementing their existing legislations. Mr. Arahona also shared that OSH strategies that UAE has implemented for the pandemic, like flexible working systems for both government and private establishments, and even their work from home policies are being considered by many employers to implement permanently. Last but not the least, to share the experiences from the Philippines, Dr. Teresita Cocueco, the Executive Director of the Occupational Safety and Health Center of the Department of Labor and Employment, share the work, environment, and health experiences of the Philippines. Dr. Cocueco shared that there was low OSH compliance among the establishment and that the top violations seen in their labor inspections involved concerns on personnel issues, on fire safety issues, and reportorial requirements. Dr. Cocueco shared that to address these gaps, the Department of Labor and Employment implements the OSH laws and policies, and they continue to inspect the OSH system. Also to strengthen, and they also wish to strengthen the human capital in OSH, among others. We ended with a healthy discussion among our participants and among our panel speakers. So for this day two of our EOH forum, we wish that we will have another healthy discussion, and we hope that you would enjoy the rest of our EOH forum. Thank you very much, and back to you, Dr. Hernandez.
Thank you, Sir Harvey, for summarizing the discussions yesterday. We sure learned a lot, and we are up for a treat with our equally important topics for this morning. Please join us in spreading our advocacy through this event. Participants are requested to post a selfie while attending this forum and use the hashtags hashtag 5th EOH Forum, hashtag SDG, and hashtag WeAreCPH. As with yesterday, kindly accomplish the evaluation forms. Your responses will be considered in planning our next offering. The link for the day two evaluation form will be shared by our staff later through Zoom chat, YouTube live chat, and the EOH Forum Google site. Our viewers here in Zoom or in YouTube live stream will also receive their certificates of attendance by accomplishing the evaluation forms. These will be emailed to the registrants immediately after the event. You are allowed to accomplish the forms until 4 p.m. of each day. Today, we have three distinguished speakers who will share their thoughts on equally important issues. We will have the second panel discussion and a special activity. The second panel discussion is titled Best Practices for the Post-Pandemic Non-Healthcare Workplace. Facilitating the discussion is Dr. Crystal Emil M. Estrada. Dr. Crystal Emil M. Estrada is a graduate of the Bachelor of Science in Public Health and Master of Public Health Programs of the College of Public Health, University of the Philippines, Manila. She completed her Doctor of Philosophy in Health Sciences and also received the University President's Award at the University of the Ryukyu in Okinawa, Japan. After obtaining her undergraduate degree, She served as a research assistant to the 5-year research program, Prevention and Control of Leptospirosis in the Philippines, a research collaboration of the UP College of Public Health, Department of Science and Technology, Philippine Council for Health Research and Development, and Japan International Cooperation Agency. Dr. Estrada's research engagements and interests are on school health and occupational health, with focus on mental health. Currently, she is serving as an associate professor in the incumbent chair of the Department of Environmental and Occupational Health, College of Public Health, University of the Philippines, Manila. I would like to turn over the virtual floor to our moderator, Dr. Tal Estrada. Over to you, Dr. Tal.
Thank you very much, Dr. Hernandez. So welcome to the second panel discussion, Best Practices for the Post-Pandemic Non-Healthcare Workplace. Yesterday, we said that across countries and industries, one of the most confronting challenges towards making work healthy is defining the post-pandemic workplace. Another is that of assimilating in our own situation the best practices of non-healthcare workplaces as they face the pandemic. We will hear about this at this panel discussion. We would like to remind our speakers that they are given 20 minutes each to share their thoughts on this topic. Messages will be sent to them via Zoom chat box to remind them of their time remaining. Our first speaker this morning is Dr. Victor Ho. Dr. Victor Ho is a professor of occupational and public health, and he is the head of the Department of Social and Preventive Medicine, Faculty of Medicine in the University of Malaya and the Public Health Department, University Malaya Medical Center. He is part of the UMMC COVID-19 Task Force since January 6, 2020. His role in the task force was to manage the environmental issues in the University Malaya Medical Center to reduce the transmission of the SARS-CoV-2 virus. He is also part of the team that developed the UMMC Risk Assessment and Surveillance System. He's working with an interdisciplinary team of researchers from the engineering and dental faculties to develop innovative methods for the risk assessment and control of COVID-19 in hospital and clinical settings. And among them was the development of the award-winning hybrid mask sterilizer and aerosol collector during dental treatment for COVID-19 prevention. The hybrid mask sterilizer is the gold medal winner at the 4th Invention Academic Conference 2020 in Korea and silver award at the Malaysia Technology Expo COVID-19 International Innovation Award 2. On the other hand, the aerosol collector during dental treatment for COVID-19 prevention received the silver award at the Malaysia Technology Expo. Dr. Ho holds a Doctor of Philosophy in Occupational Health and Safety from Monash University in Melbourne, Australia. And he has also the Master of Public Health, Master of Public Health in Occupational Health, and Master of Engineering, Safety, Health and Environment from the University of Malaya, and the Master of Occupational Health and Occupational Safety and Health from the University of Turin and the International Labor Organization International Training Center. Fellow of both the Academy of Medicine Malaysia and the Academy of Occupational and Environmental Medicine Malaysia, Professor Ho was the recipient of the first of the two International Commission for Occupational Health and ILO Master Fellowship. Let us listen to Dr. Victor Ho to hear about the protection of workers from occupational hazards in schools and universities. Over to you, Dr. Ho.
Good morning. And thank you very much, Crystal. And hopefully you can hear me and can see my slides. All right. And first, I'd like to thank the Department of Environmental and Occupational Health, College of Public Health, UP Manila, and also the CEO Mio Trocmed, Philippines Regional Center, for inviting me to the fifth EOH forum. Today, I'm going to discuss on the topic of protection of workers from occupational hazard in the schools and university. And I would like to basically look at sharing best practices from the post-pandemic workplace. So this is basically a picture in one of in the result memorial that I was in Philippines during the APEC conference, which was just completed recently. And I thank also the College of Public Health that actually invited me to present a workshop and also a forum. So what are workers' rights? Let us start with the workers' rights and what workers' rights, what is the right of the workers in the workplace? Basically, if there is some very good development in the 110th session of the International Labour Conference in June 2022, where the International Labour Conference adopted the resolution on the inclusion of safety and health working environment in the ILO framework of fundamental principles and rights at work. You must understand that before the June 2022, most of the issues that is under the International Labour Conference is basically focused on labour issues, and very few or none actually focus on occupational safety, health, and environmental issues. So moving forward, the fundamental convention includes the Occupational Safety Health Convention and also promotional framework for occupational health and health convention. How is this going to change in the context of occupational health for workers? In the context that it is going to be one of the requirements for countries which under the International Labour Organization to ensure that safety and health becomes an important component in their framework for workers in their individual countries, which is important and for us, especially in this time of post COVID-19 pandemic. So I will start with what is the lesson learned from the pandemic, and then I will share how this lesson actually has applied in our university, and also how we're moving forward and what are the risk factors or the hazards that is changing in the education sector. Since today we're going to be focusing on education sector. So protection of worker is important. And when we talk about protection of worker, we must understand that in the workplace, we must understand who are the workers or who are the people involved. And these are basically what are their risk factors, what are the depending on their what they do or their comorbidity. And also, besides the workers, we also need to look at other non-worker, which is within our organization. We also need to understand what are the equipment or equipment used in the workplace that can form as a hazard, and how this equipment can be misused, and that basically would lead to further hazard. And the other thing is the process that is involved. How can we streamline the process to make sure that the hazard doesn't recur, and we can protect each individual workers with those to ensure that they are safe. So what have changed in the education landscape during the period from 2019 until 2022? There is an acceleration of digitalization. If you'll notice it, that a lot of us actually have moved online. Currently, this conference is carried out as a webinar. This is something that we wouldn't have thought about in 2019. And having webinar, having speakers coming from vast region of the world and coming in as a digital forum basically is something that we have not thought about. But digitalization doesn't only limit to the use of webinar or online education system, but also digitalization also moved into the sector of artificial intelligence. And in the last couple of years or so, artificial intelligence have moved into the landscape of all education sectors, all educational involvement. I was basically looking at how can we write a thesis by using artificial intelligence. And there are so many tools available for you to write a thesis. There are tools for you to do paraphrasing. There are tools that actually allows you to get the structure of the thesis. There are tools that actually allow you to do many things, basically. But all these tools are artificial intelligence tools. That means if you put just two lines into the tools, and then you can get a whole structure of the thesis for ready for you. So all these things are accelerating digitalization. And how is this going to affect our education landscape in the future? And how are this going to affect the workers who is basically who need to learn, or do we need to unlearn or relearn? Because we understand the younger generation are more easily adaptable to digitalization, but some of our educators are from the older generation. When digitalization, the mention of digitalization, the mention of using computers, the mention of teaching online is basically something that is very, very foreign to them. The other thing is the next thing is basically alternative teaching, learning, and assessment method. During the COVID-19 pandemic, a lot of things, as I mentioned, is moved online. We have basically hybrid learning, which is a platform that is developed so that people can learn from home, can learn from, can come and do a physical class. But also there are also issues of assessment. How can we do assessment as a form, moving from traditional assessment of asking questions and short notes and getting direct answer, and moving to assessment where the question are basically needs the higher order thinking, and moving to the facts of how can we move from closed exam to having an open book exam or take home exam. All these things have actually occurred during the COVID-19 pandemic, and this is now currently practiced or encouraged in many universities for us to move from traditional assessment method to a more modern assessment method when we allow students to basically do take-home exam or to do assessment method which is different. And this actually raised the issue of learning again from our traditional educators, where they need to adapt and learn things in a phase that's so quick that it's difficult for them to actually grasp what do you mean, how do you progress from that. The next thing is alternative working arrangement. We understand that during the COVID-19 pandemic, as mentioned yesterday by Martes, that working from home is basically a norm, and even working from home is something that we need to focus on. But working from home itself is one of the working alternative working environment. But we understand that there's a lot of digital nomad currently, which is working for companies in the US or working for companies in Europe, but still being in the Philippines or having holiday in Thailand. So these are the working arrangement that we are talking about. And these are the risk factor, and these are the hazard that educators are going to face. Can we in the future teach while we are having a holiday or while we are abroad or while we are having a webinar or conference? Can education continue? I think all these things needs more consideration, and people need to think of it and see how can we as an educator decide on what are the hazards that how can we reduce the hazard. By understanding the hazard, by understanding the changes of the education system, now we move on to how can we more focus on risk management and control of how can we control the hazard to reduce the risk. Basically, first thing we need to do is we need to understand the risk. Hazard is something, is a harm that may occur, but the harm would occur if you are exposed to it. So there are things that you need to understand. What are the risks? And we need to also look at how can we mitigate and manage the risk. And we move back to basic. Although everything is accelerating so fast and development is moving so fast, and also especially in the COVID-19 pandemic. But by focusing, looking back, we understand that if you have the basic foundation of learning, basic foundation of knowledge, you would be able to move, to adapt to the new environment. Let us continue by understanding the risk. And this is something that is so important in this COVID-19 pandemic, where there is the issue of what are the difference between organization risk or workplace risk factor and personal risk factor. Some people, that's why it's important for us that when we are working, the risk factor for in the company should your risk in your when you are not working should not be brought into your workplace. Your risk perception, how you perceive risk from non-work environment should not bring to the work environment. That's why there's quite a difficulty. When the difficulty lies when we basically there is work and non-work become unison, especially when we're talking about working from home. When is work and when is non-work environment? So these issues are key things that we need to focus on. And that's why we're talking about how can we balance between personal and work and organization risk. And also, what do we mean by risk perception? How do you perceive risk in the when you are working for your personal risk? How can we translate that into workplace risk? So there are basically when we're talking about hazard, there are two types of main hazard that is there in the workplace. There's safety hazard and health hazard. So safety hazard is something that of course most of you know here because it's very simple. Like things that is easier for us to see, easier for us to understand, like slipping, tripping, fire hazard, moving parts, machinery, tools, equipment, working at height, injection of materials, pressure system, moving vehicle, projection and flying objects, like lifting and other manual handling operation, and maybe even gun violence in school, especially if you talk about schools that in the US where gun violence become a problem and people need to protect their children from gun violence, for different students from gun violence. And of course, we have health hazard. We have the five main health hazard: physical hazard, chemical hazard, biological hazard, ergonomic hazard, and psychosocial hazard. These hazards are present in schools and also in university. The physical hazard, the radiation, the noise, the other environment, and the chemical hazard presence in the chemical laboratory. That is part of teaching, part of learning, and also biological hazard present as a in the laboratory also is a problem in schools and things like that. And of course, we have ergonomic hazard and we have psychosocial hazard. But moving forward, as we discussed, how does this hazard change in the post-pandemic era? Is that something different, or is it still the same? We must understand the biological hazard that we have. Previously, we always think of biological hazard that we introduce into the workplace, that we use, like the rat is in the laboratory, the organism that we use for doing experiment, the frog that we use in the laboratory. Those are hazards that we introduce into the system, into the process of working, of doing it. Ergonomic, the same thing. We are talking about ergonomic in a standard environment, in the classroom where everything is set for you clearly, in your office where everything is set. And psychosocial hazard is there's no change. You know, change is a problem. When change is too extensive, people would basically it's difficult for people to adapt to change. But currently, after the pandemic, we understand that biological hazard doesn't only focus on biological hazard that's introduced, but also biological hazard, including human, student, lecturer, co-workers, bringing in biological hazard into the workplace. And ergonomic hazard basically have changed, not from just having a standardized classroom when you can actually focus on how to improve ergonomic to working from home or alternative working environment where you don't actually focus or think of ergonomic hazard in your home. And psychosocial hazard is the changes that is happening currently in the education environment. There's so much changes moving from digitalization, looking at alternative learning, and teaching, looking at alternative assessment method. All those things are causing psychological hazard, psychosocial stress to our educators. And this is not just happening. This is happening in New Zealand, which basically everybody was discussing it. You know, when we talk about how can we move from traditional assessment to more modern assessment, that was resistance. How can we move from a face-to-face lecture to online lecture or to hybrid lecture? There is a lot of resistance that comes into play. That what are the human context is there? Do we have human context? This is a webinar, which is good, but we lost the human contact, like what I would have preferred, like what I did for the APEC to come. So there are issues that are very, very different from pre-pandemic era. The post-pandemic is something that everything is accelerated and we are moving fast. We are moving so fast. So mitigation and management. Of course, the risk control measure is basically, we know that if there's a source, we can control the source, or can control the path, or we can protect the person. The traditional way of looking at it is looking at it from elimination, substitution, engineering control, and managed control, and the use of personal protective equipment. But in moving forward, when we're looking at physical hazard, chemical hazard, biological hazard, economic hazard, and psychosocial hazard, in the traditional way, yes, these things still work. But for biological hazard, in the modern environment, when you're focusing on how can we control people coming in with a biological symptom and come into the class. So the hierarchy of control might be different. Is the hierarchy of control for controlling biological hazard the same or not? Or can we eliminate? Which is basically something that we have thought about, that for control of biological hazard, both engineering and administrative and PPE control are important in the context of, in the full context. So let's move back to basic, which is where we started off. We must understand the risk. We must know how to conduct workplace assessment. We must know how to implement control measures. All these things are taught as your foundation in your education system when you're learning. And we can actually, we must teach our students to be able to adapt and change with the foundation that they have taken and have learned. And that is how we can move forward. So we must focus on the people, we must understand the equipment and the process that is in place. And of course, we must have effective communication, and we understand communication is a problem, especially in the COVID era. Thank you very much.
Doctor, you're muted.
Okay. So thank you very much, Dr. Ho, for sharing how the workers in schools and universities are being protected from occupational hazards. So we heard Dr. Ho focusing on people, processes, and the equipment. So our next speaker will discuss how health promotion is conducted in the business setting. Let us welcome Dr. Renato Joseph. Dr. Joseph completed 4 science degrees, health sciences degree programs, the Master of Occupational Health, Doctor of Medicine, Bachelor of Science in Nursing, and Bachelor of Science in Medical Technology from globally known academic institutions. He has over 35 years of practical experience in occupational health and safety. His OHS practice encompasses global corporate safety and health management systems, quality standards, and other applicable programs and policies. His particular expertise is on OHS leadership and management, policy development and implementation, including training and communication. The focal areas of his experience include health and wellness, stress management in the workplace for the general and specific population, and infection prevention and control programs. Dr. Joseph was formerly assistant professor at the College of Public Health, University of the Philippines, Manila, a human resource section manager of a multinational company, and a consultant of multinational and local corporations, national and international health agencies for more than 15 years. He is currently an OHS internal consultant for an interior architectural construction company and a freelance health and wellness OHS trainee. Dr. Joseph is also currently an adjunct faculty of the Department of Environmental and Occupational Health, College of Public Health, University of the Philippines, Manila. Let us all welcome Dr. Joseph. You may proceed with your presentation, Dr. Joseph.
Thank you very much, dear Chair, Dr. Crystal. Let me thank this opportunity while I'm sharing my slide to thank the chair of this fifth Environmental and Occupational Health Forum by this prestigious department, of course, the College of Public Health. Let me share you my presentation now. Thank you very much, Professor Galen, for giving me the opportunity, for having me here in this globally renowned forum of occupational health. Can you see my slide now?
Not yet, sir. It's now sharing.
All right. Thank you. Is it okay?
We can see your slide deck, not yet in presenter's view. Thank you.
Thank you. Is it okay?
Yes, sir.
Thank you very much. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I'm going to present here the health promotion program in medium-scale business enterprises represented by Walls in Motion, of which I'm a current consultant in their occupational and health programs and services. So I have four learning objectives for this 20-minute session. At the end of the session, I'm expecting that all participants, it's you, would be able to explain the global perspectives of workplace health promotion, from where I'll be discussing the application of the fundal elements to a medium-scale business enterprise. I will be presenting to justify the company's health promotion program in relation to lessons learned, and I will end my presentation by some recommendations. So to support my objectives, I have the following items as a flow of my discussion. So briefly, this is my disclosure and disclaimer of all the presentations that I'm having for this 20-minute forum. Okay. Walls in health promotion, as defined by World Health Organization Ottawa Charter in 2018, is a process of enabling people to increase control over and to improve their health. The expectation, the end in mind, as our guru in leadership management, Mr. Stephen Covey, says that begin with the end in mind, and we expect that changes in personal characteristics, behaviors, and skills of all workers should be changed there, and social norms and activities, as well as the organizational practices. Health promotion places at the center the broad developmental agenda. So therefore, we're talking not only of the company, but the community, the national and international agenda as well. So health promotion in the workplace engages individuals with leadership potential in transformative process that aims to change mindsets in order to take risks in company setting. It's just simply moving beyond focus, going an extra mile. The International Labor Organization, on the other hand, complements occupational safety and health measures in their health promotion and well-being at work programs definition of health promotion program. It combines the efforts of employers, workers, and national authorities to improve the health and well-being of men and women at work. So it focuses on different areas on health promotion, such as workplace stress, violence at work, drug and alcohol abuse, promotion of tobacco-free workplaces. In other words, ILO expanded it to a more broader agenda. For the meantime, Centers for Disease Control and Prevention defines health promotion as one that creates wellness culture that is employee-centered. It is providing supportive environments where safety is ensured and health can emerge. So therefore, it access and gives opportunities to engage the workers in a variety of workplace health programs. So in a summary, I have gotten some material from European Network for Workplace Health Promotion. Here is a slide that gives us the drivers and the results of when implementing workplace health promotion program. So it entails a great deal of leadership, an effective one, a workplace culture, and participation of the employees. The mid portion of the slide shows us the workplace health determinants and the processes that are important to achieve the goal or the results, which is basically work and life quality of all workers. So you see there is performance in innovation, and down the line, it would be a cycle of improvement all throughout. To effectively implement health promotion program, as a specialist in occupational health and safety, I really recommend that health promotion program should be having health and safety culture on top. So we have 5 key actions in here. 1, develop personal leadership skills and competencies. Formulate and sustain healthy policy in all things that we do in the company. Creating an enabling, supportive, and healthy environment. Strengthen community action. And the last, but not of course, the least important, which I feel is very important in my presentation, is to deculturalize if the situation requires. The material of making the case workplace health promotion, authored by, as mentioned in my source in this slide, comes up with a set of benefits of implementing workplace health promotion. So we see here it is divided into 2, organizational outcomes and individual outcomes. So in the end, we are here to achieve company goals. Just as the previous slide would tell us, it goes a cycle of improvement each time. We always go measuring the programs every time and performance and down and all over and over again. Yeah, PricewaterhouseCoopers references sick absence, staff turnover, accidents, injuries, claims, and compensation and profitability as one of the top advantages of promoting or implementing workplace health promotion programs in any workplace. And there are also lots of results which deal with employee satisfaction, company profile, expansion at that for the business, productivity of employees, and generally the health and welfare of all the employees involved. So let me now share you the health promotion of Walls in Motion Incorporated, which is a medium-scale business enterprise based in Pasig, in Ortigas, Pasig City. As a background, let me just start with a brief history here that the company was started by an American businessman in 1997, which was later acquired by the family of Mr. George Nikau. Experiencing an enormous growth potential in the country, in Asia, in the construction agency. In fact, now you are seeing the boxes there. The company specializes in all sorts of interior architectural and construction products. And the workforce in general has adopted a Filipino family culture type of running the business. So when we come to design a health promotion program, we always start with a strategic alignment with the mission, vision, and values of the company. So here, the Walls in Motion, mission is to provide quality space management solutions at a reasonable cost, and a vision to be recognized nationwide at that. as the best space management solutions company with a diversified production portfolio supported with mindfulness, teamwork, open communication as its values. Having said that, having linked or anchor with the company and mission, vision, and objectives, and of course, vision, we have to go on a different mode of connecting ourselves with the international agencies' global standards. For here, I am presenting a sample checklist that it would be very helpful to go over through it as we design the program. So this is from International Labor Organization, which outlines the assessment, planning, workplace governance, implementation, and evaluation. So I made use of this tool from the very start. Right. So as in this checklist, it is very important to know the employee demographics of the company. So here we are seeing that, of course, the company is very heavy on its production and operation workforce with the support of the other personnel. And then we have also job positions wherein the production and operations worker rank the top. In terms of the sex in the population, it is apparent that there are many males over females. And the average age of the workers is pegged at 39 years old, with the majority in the 35 to 49 years old. It is very important to emphasize that it's very important at this point in time, because we all know, as a physiological and an anatomical sense of our human body, the disease or the lifestyle diseases generally crops up from the time the individual worker is at 35 years old up to the time that he would or she would be at the peak of his or her age at 50 years old. So we are really in this age group. It is also important to review the current health and medical profile of each and everybody. And as a group, I have found out that most of our employees do have hypertension and the other lifestyle health disease, which is diabetes, and a combination thereof. So in terms of the weight categories, I think this represents the general population, not only the Filipino workforce, but the international workforce as well. In Walls in Motion, it is pegged that 51% of our employees are belonging to the obese category and the overweight as well. So the residences here, it's very important to know the culture and other ways that go with their lifestyle, including their modes of transportation when going to and fro from the office. So it is noted that most of our employees do take the public transport and the motorcycle as modes of vehicle. As part of the situation analysis and designing a program, it is a very important consideration to include the budgetary requirements of the program vis-a-vis the budget of the company. So it's not about compromising employee needs, but rather have a balance between what they need and what the company could offer as a program. So my realization is I would really hammer this into a concretized information that better health is correlated with productivity, effectiveness, employee satisfaction and retention, and worker health is determined by factors such as hazards, social and environmental factors. We have to focus ourselves on the promotion in general, health and well-being, and then the defining work environment for improved health employee safety. So as part, again, of a master plan, I have conceptualized and thereby planning the strategic and the tactical elements of the program. So later, I will be discussing the prioritization, the monitoring and evaluation, which are vital components of a program plan. Why do we need to have to include the sustainability plan at the outset? It's very important because we know for a fact, for lack of a better term, and I hate to say this, that we in the Filipino culture are fan of what we say, the Ningas Kugon mentality. So for me, I really deem it important to include sustainability plan at the outset. Should be part of the planning from the very start. And we have to factor in the manpower and the budgetary resources of each of the programs and the program elements. It is very important to consider that we must anticipate roads as we implement the program. So in other terms, in other terminologies, we have to have perseverance in implementing any kind of program. So persistence is a key. Strategies may change, but we have to stick to our goals as we have decided on from the very start. So questions to probably ask ourselves would be, are the necessary resources available? If not, what are the plans on resources? What are the contingency plans, which should be quite flexible when it comes to budgetary resources? So now let me go through on the value of prioritization. In this particular consultancy project that I have with Walls in Motion, I deem it very important to set prioritization criteria because, as I have mentioned, this is a medium scale business and enterprise. So it's very important to be sensitive about the coverage and the resources that it could afford to support the program. So I started it with the following criteria: the coverage under the regulations of our OSAs and other laws of the country, feasibility of the solution, existence of the issue, temporary solution is there, and the impact of the company if not implemented, including the penalty provision based on OSS standards. For everybody's information, it is a big amount actually to have a deficiency in any of the occupational health and services program. So I focus on the top priorities for the 6 months. And by the way, this is my 6 month in the company, and I will be sustaining the program to 1 year as per my boss's advice and request for me to stay. And I make this prioritization guide as a guide in the adjustment of supporting resources whenever I implement these programs and programs activities. What do we monitor? Of course, the strategies and activities. And what do we evaluate? We evaluate the objective of the program. I always emphasize this because as leaders or implementers of the program, we have to determine when to monitor and what to monitor and when to evaluate and what to evaluate. So I have in my slide sample monitoring items and sample evaluation items. So let us take a glance on the program of the company. Of course, I'm so glad that I had the chance or opportunity to teach at the UP College of Public Health Department of Environment and Occupational Health by handling the particular subject or course on legislation. So I handled occupational safety, health and standards, and other regulations. And now, when I was abroad, I noted that during the most recent presidency, under his secretary, they implemented this Department Order 198. It was and is an awesome department order, and I salute the leadership of these people under the previous administration. So what I did was, based on the department order, I customized it to the situation of the company. So I have A, B to H, the different categories of the program components, which is, by the way, the core of it all. So in other words, I started designing the health promotion program by starting with the core programs as defined by the department order. So in other words, if you notice, if we marry the discussion earlier I made, it is about the International Labor Organization model, where I integrate the occupational health safety programs with the health promotion program. So the next step that I did was to define the different elements. So first, the commitment of the management on the OHS program and services of the company, the conduct of hazard identification, risk assessment and control, medical surveillance, and down the line. At the horizontal level, the uppermost level, we could see the general programs, basic OHS elements, the promotion and prevention, the OHS training and communication, welfare facilities, work environmental measurement, appropriate management, and the mainstays of control. I will go through it one by one. Okay. Before we go any further, what I did was to make a matrix, and I integrate in the chart a prioritization criteria, which I have discussed earlier. So I set 7 criteria, as I have discussed earlier. And I know this is a kind of eye test for you there. And I don't mind sharing these slides with you on a request basis through the Department of Force and the College of Public Health. So the covered by OHS regulations is just simply yes or no, the feasibility, and with three subcategories, long-standing issue down the line. So I have their different point system, and then came up with a different color code, which says that if it's red, it is a warning. It's yellow, needs further enhancement. It's a blue, good, strive to have an excellent level by mid-November. And I think we're achieving this. And below 110, very good and excellent. What I'm pointing out here is for the black one, the lowest level, we could stay it aside. And while for the meantime, concentrate on the red and the yellow particularly. So to effectively implement this, the first thing that I did was to organize the health and safety committee, and headed by the owner and the managing director, and of course our committee chairman, my immediate boss here, the attorney Christian Abelunar, and I think he's watching. We have representatives from all divisions of Walls in Motion, and we meet every second and fourth Fridays with adequate or appropriate protocols and procedures compliant upon. We also have to ensure that these issues are elevated to the MANCOM. In other words, we have to make the issues that are discussed in the committee, like, for lack of a better term, a gospel truth that everyone should respect in the company. And the committee's top responsibility is to follow through on compliance to ensure completion. All right, so these are the subsequent slides are some specific details here. For the awareness training communication, we have dedicated bulletin boards, and we have implemented the DOL mandatory 8-hour training course on OHS. Again, I salute the leadership of the past administration to make this happen. It's really awesome. Dr. Teresita Cocueto, the executive director, I really believe in this 8 hours. So far, as of date, we have hit a 94% training attendance on this particular course. And now we are carrying it over as a part of our new employee orientation. So I conducted these BAT sessions, 11 of them, from July to September 2022. Right, so we issue certificates here. We have as I've said earlier, we have a 94 good hit rate of this course. And now we are into the advanced OHS courses, which I personally designed, advanced HIRAC, 5S housekeeping, hazard communication, advanced ergonomics. Since our production and operations are mostly or 65% manual, it's very important that I will be concentrating on manual handling procedures. I also having warehouse ergonomics and chemical safety, stress management for office personnel, particularly specific personal protective equipment, defensive driving for our drivers, disaster management for our disaster preparedness group, and leadership in occupational health and safety for the Walls in Motion Executive Committee. So my recommendation, and by the way, it was approved by management, that all of these courses will be cascaded to specific employee groups, which is started last month, to be conducted 1 to 2 courses per month in the entire 2023. And I require each employee to complete at least 4 hours of these advanced OHS courses. Okay, you see, our operations and production are very hard on manual efforts. Therefore, I concentrate on manual handling procedures. Here's for you, ladies and gentlemen, and this is one of my humbling experience in the company. The value of awareness training communication. If you see here in this picture, this worker had hard time pushing the push cart in a rugged stone, in a rugged pathway made of stones. So because of, I believe it was appropriately communicated to all employees, from the rank and file to the workers, from the workers to the executive level, they appreciate the impact of this, and therefore the MANCOM of this wonderful group, this wonderful company, they decided to have this pavement cemented. Now the workers are so much enjoying the cemented floor, no need for excessive musculoskeletal efforts here. So that's why this is thus emphasizing the value of awareness, training, and communication for this specific program element. Okay, and we also have monthly thematic sessions on promotion and prevention and control of health domains. If you remember, I noted that diabetes mellitus and hypertension are the two top lifestyle diseases. So therefore, I deem it important to have healthy lifestyle advocacy awareness. And moving further, because obesity also occupied a greater part of the pie, I deem it very important to go further. And I am conducting body fat caliper measurements for every employee every 3 to 6 months. All right, because we know for a fact that obesity, just like all the other bad chemistry elements, are risk factors, including the work stress to the development of cardiovascular diseases. Now, up to present, since July 2022, I am into the involvement of our drug-free workplace program. Consultation with employees is ongoing, and I am reviewing the draft policy that I have done with my attorney boss. And this also pending is the drug assessment team training that I'm proposing with the Occupational Safety and Health Center with the help and support of my batch mates. By the way, we are the first batch to undergo this training with Occupational Health and Safety Center on drug assessment team training. All right, so this is HIRAC, Hazard Identification, Risk Control and Management, which Dr. Cocueco had emphasized yesterday. I make sure that I visit the different sites on a regular basis, like at least twice a month, two operations I visit, and then conduct HIRAC on these operation sites. And then I also see to it that I conduct walkthrough observation as a routine task every day, early morning and in the afternoon, and of course midday, I go around the factory or the production site and make sure that HIRAC is in place. Now, of course, we should have this as a focus. COVID-19 policies and procedures. I started when I started my consultancy in June. I took over the program, and good news, up to this time, we also already have a total of 116 people who have been vaccinated, except for the 7 who do not have the data. So I categorize based on the CDC categorization of vaccination status. Our employees are 42 out of 116 are fully vaccinated. Updated, meaning they have completed their first and second booster doses. This is the best protection at 67. So, and now still ongoing. Now, proper housekeeping are mainstays of OHS, same through as waste management and disaster preparedness plan. One of the things that I also situate is a proper housekeeping, and in the office, I'm implementing not only in the office, but as well as the production and operation side, the very popular 5S housekeeping. It works really very nicely in the company. People tend to be more organized, and they are very systematic in their procedures. And I also make sure that I network with the community services, just like the fire substation for our disaster preparedness plan, and also the private waste haulers, which this has already been in place since I first came into Walls in Motion. And we started the clinic, the first aid station, which is a requirement of the government. And of course, it is also a service provider in-house or in-plant for our workers. So I'm also serving as the doctor, at the same time, the nurse as well. And we also have this portable drinking water, sanitary fixing facilities, adequate resting areas, pavement, and good parking space for our employees and the visitors. So we're still working on the different improvements with the end in mind of having a healthy workforce and safe and working environment. Another thing that I'm doing is providing access to the community health services for our employees. So we belong under Barangay Rosario in Pasig City. So I visited the municipal health office, the city health office, and I got in touch with a wonderful team. And I am so amazed with their services here, complete at least for the basic needs of the population in the community, which includes our workforce. So not only our workers, but as well as their dependents as well. So they also have the other laboratory and ancillary procedures. So it is like about 1.5 kilometers from our facility, from Walls in Motion. And around our area, I got network also with the Pasig City, Pasig Doctors Medical Center, the Pasig City General Hospital, and the Mission Hospital for the emergency needs and, of course, hospitalization accessibilities of our employees. Not to mention, of course, not to forget the Alfonso Specialist Hospital also. Now, as a corporate social responsibility, we tied up with PhilInvest Sorrento Oasis on their COVID-19 booster vaccination day. And thank you for the Department of Health and the local
government. Can you conclude your presentation, please? Thank you.
Pasig City Health Office. So we also have the have to iterate the right communication strategy. Okay. Oops. Okay, so moving forward, sustainability and a new program, workplace spirituality program and mental health program. I deem it very important because of the current crisis that we're undergoing. The mental health is rising in the country and globally at that. The COVID-19 pandemic crisis is terribly impacting the anxiety level of the workers. And because of the ego self-centeredness of our population, we have to have spirituality vis-a-vis mental health program. So because of self-centeredness, because of things like this, it's only we cannot do it alone, but we need a divine intervention for ourselves. So here, and by the way, this has already been approved by the management of Pulse in Motion. So everything will be treated with utmost confidentiality on the personal circumstances. And I have outlined here the specific of these programs, all right? And the recommendation is walk the talk, be everyone's model, especially the leaders, make use of the OHS organization and the various teams in the current organization, utilize enterprise social media for communication, obtain experts' inputs, insights, and opinions, and design a workplace mental health program and workplace spirituality program. So key takeaways is a high program, the health promotion to increase control over the employee's health, to institute changes. The essential elements are outlined here, which should be integrated in the company's OASIS program. A participative management is a vital key, and the different processes should be undergone so that we have a robust health promotion program. Communication plan and sustainability plan should be there. Improvement cycles should always be there for the realization of the formulated vision of the Walls in Motion. So thank you for the top management of the company, Pasig City Health Office, Barangay Super Health Center, DOLE, OHSC, and of course, the University of Manila, Department of Environmental Health, College of Public Health. So these are my references. Thank you for your time, and we praise the Lord for all the glory that we are sharing with our Divine Almighty. Thank you.
Right. Thank you very much, Dr. Joseph, for sharing how to promote health in the setting of medium-scale businesses. We will take up questions after your talk, and we will be able to discuss more, and you may be able to share more than during our question and answer portion. Thank you very much again, Dr. Joseph. Our last speaker will now discuss occupational disease and disability prevention in public institutions. Let us all welcome Mr. Buford Ang. Mr. Buford Ang is a graduate of the BS Biochemistry Program of the University of Santo Tomas, Philippines, and is its 2021 Distinguished Alumnus from the Faculty of Pharmacy. He obtained his multiple graduate degrees from the United States, among them, MS Environmental Health and Post-Baccalaureate Certificate in Public Health Preparedness, Response and Recovery, University of Minnesota, Master in Public Health Environmental Health Science, University of Michigan, Ann Arbor, and Online Human Factors and Ergonomics Program, Center for Occupational and Environmental Health, University of California, Berkeley. Currently, Mr. Ang is a senior specialist in industrial hygiene for a state-owned oil company in the Middle East, and he had previously worked in a similar capacity in Qatar with Golder Associates of Singapore and the Philippine Department of Labor and Employment, Occupational Safety and Health Center. He was also senior safety manager, Office of Safety, Health and Environment, at the National University of Singapore. Mr. Ang is a certified industrial hygienist by the American Board of Industrial Hygiene. He's also a certified safety professional from the Board of Certified Safety Professionals and a certified hazardous materials manager of the Institute of Hazardous Materials Management. You may now proceed with your presentation, Mr. Ang.
Good morning, everyone. I'll attempt to share my screen. Can everyone at least hear or see me?
Yes, we can hear you loud and clear.
Okay, just a moment. Let me try to go here. Can everyone see the slides?
Yes, we can see the slides, sir.
Okay. Well, welcome, everyone. For today, just for a short 20-minute talk, I will give a rundown of how the occupational disease and disability prevention mechanism works here in the United Arab Emirates. My specific focus would be more on a government-owned oil and gas corporation because this is where I work. But I will also give you an idea or a framework or structure on how from a government perspective itself, how we manage occupational disease and disability for our entire population. So for the learning outcomes, this is my outline. So I will go a little bit on the demographics, the leadership structure, so where I will discuss the framework, the relationship between an agency, or in our case, it could be the federal or the ministry level versus the industry, a typical OSH personal composition, which outlines the minimum requirements. I will go down a little bit on the wellness continuum, meaning this is where the model of the primary, secondary, and tertiary prevention lies, which is the heart of disability prevention itself. And I'll go deeper into the primary, secondary, and tertiary prevention. It's a laundry list, but I will just highlight the most important ones because we have very limited time. And the last one will be the way forward. Just to give you an idea on the demographics of United Arab Emirates, this is the map. On the right side is basically the population makeup of the country. This is a country of 9.8 million people. It's predominantly dominated by the South Asian population, which is which takes about 55% of the population. And the Emirati here constitutes about 11.6% of the population, so barely a million. But the rest, there's a big Arab group, and we Filipinos also are a significant group of the population. We take about 6.1% of the chunk. In the United Arab Emirates, there are 7 emirates. We have Abu Dhabi, as you can see, the yellow shade of the map. We have Dubai, we have Sharjah, we have Umm Al Quwain, we have Ras Al Khaimah, we have Fujairah and Ajman. So this is just basically a composition of, so you will have an idea on what would be the diversity and of the workforce population. This is the breakdown of these workers by industries. So as you can see here, construction predominates the list. If you have a chance to visit United Arab Emirates, I would invite you to come here and visit. But it's more of dominated by construction, especially in Dubai and other Emirates. They emphasize visibility is very important here. So you can see if you go to Dubai, the construction industry is very big, and it's predominates majority, or it takes majority of the chunk of the entire workforce. Followed by wholesale and retail trade, because we are also into services, real estate, manufacturing, and transport. And the rest is the other service sectors and the community institutions as well. With regard to disability statistics, you can see here in the pie chart, the majority of the lost time injuries is predominated by the transport and trade sector and services as well, which constitute about 62% of the injuries. Although industry itself, we have a lot of sectors here, they take about 25% of the pie or the entire composition. And the last one would be construction. So, majority in the United Arab Emirates is driven by a service-based industry and construction-based. So when you translate this to occupational diseases, the top diseases here as per the statistics available would be cardiovascular disease, cancers, and respiratory disorders. As you can see, United Arab Emirates belongs to the Middle East. There's a lot of areas here which have deserts. So you can somehow visualize, especially during the transition from winter to summer, that there's a lot of desert sand. So that this accounts for the respiratory disorders because of their exposure to the dust that they breathe, whether it's inhalable or respirable dust. That's where the interaction happens. I'll give you an idea on the OSH framework. As you know, we have a federal level and we have an emirate level. So for an Abu Dhabi perspective, this is where I work right now in Abu Dhabi. We have what we call the OSHAD, which is basically the occupation itself, the Occupational Safety and Health Abu Dhabi. This is an institution which manages all the OSH-related policies and services. So you can see here that the OSHAD is the heart, and they work with other competent authorities. We call them the sector regulatory authorities. For example, if you want to deal with radiation perspective or issues, we have what we call the Federal Authority for Nuclear Regulation. And you have other, if you want to deal with petroleum issues, we have what we call the Supreme Council for Economic and Financial Affairs. So they all interact together. But in the Emirate of Abu Dhabi, they all come back to OSHAD to refer for the policies. But at the same time, the SRAs also have the independence and authority to draft their own OSH policies, and that will be trickled down to their respective employees. So this is just to give you an idea from an Emirate level, and this is, I used an Abu Dhabi as an example. And for the federal level, which is the higher level, it's usually led by the cabinet, which is not found in the slide, followed by the federal government, then it trickles down to the ministry, which is basically the leadership. In a typical ministry setup, you have the assistant undersecretary or the CEO, then you have the HR department connected to it. And it's either the HR department houses the occupational health and safety functions. In other cases, it could be the HSE department itself. They can have, if they have enough people, they could have their own department. So inside an HSE department, you have what we call the OHS expert or the occupational health and safety expert. There's a team under him or her, and there's an occupational health and safety agent. So basically, the expert is basically the subject matter expert who is driving the implementation of the OSH policies. And you have the agents who help the expert in trickling it down to the respective departments and divisions. You also have, they all report to the department head and the line manager, which all goes down to the CEO and back to the ministry. And there's on the side, there's what we call the strategic planning and excellence, which monitor key performance indicators, how the ministry is performing with regard to occupational safety and health performance, for instance. Going back to Abu Dhabi, here in this Emirate, there's a minimum requirement. So, but the number of OSH personnel is dependent on the number of entities operating for that particular company or organization, the complexity and nature of the frequency of operations and activities undertaken, and the level of OSH capacity and development. But at the minimum, we have what we call the senior manager, team leader, section head, and the OSH lead auditor, who will help drive the effective implementation of an OSH policy for the Emirate. It could be more expanded, but this is what the law of Abu Dhabi requires at the minimum. Now let's go to the wellness continuum. As you can see here, I took this from Chenoweth, which I think is a very illustrative on how a prevention mechanism should work for handling occupational disability. We have the primary, which is basically preventive in terms of health promotion and providing wellness incentives. Dr. Joseph gave a good talk on this, and there's a lot of overlaps. And also immunization, especially right now, I mean, with the last 2 years, of the COVID-19 pandemic. We have also the secondary prevention, which focuses on health protection and monitoring and workplace screening. And we have the tertiary prevention, which deals with disability case management. I would focus my talk on health promotion and welfare very quickly, health risk management and control, and disability case management. So you would have an idea on how we manage things. But I summarize them in a tabular form. So for health promotion and welfare, some of the components that we have in our government-controlled corporation would be, of course, welfare management. As you can see earlier in the slide, we have a big workforce coming from different countries, predominantly South Asian. They predominate the entire the workforce itself. We also have the water safety, the food hygiene, the fatigue risk management initiatives. So these are some of the basic components for welfare, since The big problem actually with welfare is because of the diversity, the language issues, the language barrier issues, and having their salaries paid on time. Although there's already a wage protection system here, there are still companies who violate the law. So that's why I highlighted management of wages salary issues, which I think is one of the most important case, because this is related. If they don't receive their money on time, they tend to have some psychosocial issues, which leads to non-accidental deaths, like suicide. So I think this is very important. This should be managed well. Other components, as I've mentioned, is drinking water safety, food safety inspections to make sure that we should avoid foodborne poisoning, and training. ADAFCA here means Abu Dhabi Food Control Authority, which is one of the sector regulatory authorities. And EFST means Essential Food Safety Training. So from a preventive approach, we do training and awareness, and we make sure that our food handlers are licensed with ADAFCA, and they have attended the basic training courses required to manage or prevent any occurrences of foodborne illnesses or diseases. And as well, we have fatigue risk management procedure, because a majority of the workers here work more than 8 hours. So we think that fatigue management, having a procedure and appropriate training for the workers is very important in how to cope up with their work shifts. Of course, occupational health and education to development is important, because we need to do campaigns, we need to do survey, and we also need to develop the competencies of our people, meaning how can we implement the program properly if our people are not competent, right? So majority here is, I want to emphasize on beat the heat, because we have summer months and we have a midday break rule here from June to September, and it's very hot. It's more than 40 degrees Celsius. In some cases, it reaches 50 degrees Celsius. So so that's why we hit stress management is important, because this is one critical factor that is contributory to the occurrence of a disability for a particular worker. Another one for secondary prevention is health risk management and control. This will be another lecture, but I just want to emphasize how important occupational health risk assessment is. I'm an industrial hygienist myself, and so that's why I want to emphasize the mantra of AREC, which is Anticipation, Recognition, Evaluation, and Control of Health Hazards. We have a lot of projects here, and we have several companies under our organization. That's why we need to identify already the health hazards from its inception. So we identify this during the front-end engineering design phase, the engineering procurement and construction phase, the operational phase, so and the decommissioning and disposal phase. So we handle health hazards from cradle to grave. We zoom in on the worker similarly exposed group. We identify which work activities are associated with the certain health hazards. We assign a health risk rating for that. We measure their exposures, whether it's airborne, skin, or even from the biological monitoring perspective, if it corresponds to a certain metabolite. And we continuously monitor them through a proper health screening and surveillance, which I will explain later. Going deeper into the health hazard management, we have hearing conservation, because we have noise issues. So we have a lot of noisy equipment. So this is some of the initiatives that we have. Recently, we had a noise awareness conference, and we had speakers from in-house, and we also invited speakers from other international institutions to deliver a talk on how they can recognize, manage, evaluate, and manage or control hazardous levels of noise. Other initiatives include radiation protection, heat stress management, and psychosocial risk management. If you remember your industrial hygiene courses in college or maybe in your postgrad, management for radiation protection would be dealing with the exposure time, the isolating yourself from the source or the equipment, basically distance, and shielding. Recently, we had an International Atomic Energy Agency inspection they inspected one of our radioactive waste treatment facility. So this is one good initiative to prevent any interaction or exposure to radiation sources. Another one would be, as I've mentioned already, heat stress management. Recognition here is the key, the symptom recognition and body system and how. So we have a lot of posters, we have a lot of videos, we disseminate it from this employee level all the way to the contractor and subcontractor level, from the direct hires to the contractors. We even have posters in comfort groups where they would recognize when they use the bathroom, what are the signs and symptoms of being dehydrated by monitoring the color of the urine. So these are some very important indicators that can assist you in preventing from the occurrence of any heat stress-related illness or incidents. Another one would be psychosocial risk management, because we have a lot of wellhead platforms and a lot of remote work areas as well. And this is contributory also to the occurrence, unfortunately, if non-accidental, deaths in the form of suicide. So if you don't handle your mental health very well, things could go wrong. So that's why we need to recognize it at a very early stage. And there should be a robust training and awareness, which we currently do. Others include ergonomics management. You guys are from public health, you know, the carpal tunnel syndrome, low back pain. These are the most common suspects from both the office and industrial perspective. So we roll out a questionnaire, a self-administered questionnaire to the employees. From there, we identify which are the most exposed employees, and we do an assessment with our competent occupational health subject matter experts and provide the employee necessary advice or redesign the workstation on the spot. Chemical management is also critical, because this deals with identifying it from a HAZCOM perspective, evaluating any existing and new chemicals, and doing the COSH assessment. Basically, if you're familiar with the UK law, it's control of substances hazardous to health. So we will be able to gauge the risk level by just simply studying the safety data sheet and monitoring it by conducting quantitative risk assessment. We also deal with emergency response issues, just in case there's a leak on sites. And the chemical register, the inventory should always be there for chemicals, so it will be easier for emergency responders to respond. For the secondary prevention, we have the health screening, health surveillance, and alcohol drug screening. This is important. We manage the health of the workers from pre-employment stage, periodic transfer, and return to work. We also do exit interview to improve the worker leaves, because this is an important document. Just in case someone files a case or claim, we will be able to investigate both the airborne data and the medical data to validate the claim if it's really valid or not. And we have the age-based periodic medical exam. The older you get, the more frequent the medical examination is. But the limit usually here is around 60 before the worker is asked to leave the company. But in other cases, it could be there's some exceptions. Health surveillance, this is for specific agents which have a biological corresponding biological metabolite indicator. So we also do that. There are some chemicals which have that, and there are also radiological exposures which have some biological indicators that need to be monitored. So we identify which worker groups are affected, how do we handle them, what tests needs to be done, and how often, depending on the risk identified from the airborne data. And as well as we have alcohol and drug screening. But as you know, we don't tolerate alcohol in our corporation. We have a zero tolerance for alcohol. But at work, I mean. So because because it's a culture issue. I mean, majority of them, they call it, they treat it as haram if you go to work institutions, especially here in UAE. Last would be the disability case management. We try to avoid this, but case management is critical here. So you will be able to classify cases in terms of first aid case, medical treatment case, restricted workday case, lost workday case, permanent, partial, and total disability. So this is if the worker is already injured, like, for example, noise-induced hearing loss, ergonomics issues. So we aid the worker through readjustment so he or she can go back to the workplace, or we will reassign them in a work that will be fit to the worker. Others include occupational illness investigation, if there's someone got sick, and non-accidental death investigation, which deals primarily with contractors, especially because of the risk factors that I've already mentioned earlier. And this is my last slide. These are some of my recommendations for way forward. Although the data is there for occupational diseases, it was difficult to find some actual data. So I had to use a lot of peer-reviewed references for this. So I think there needs to be a more robust collection and analysis of occupational disease data, so we will be able to identify which risk factors are affecting the occurrence of such. We also hope that there should be a stronger collaboration between the UAE entities and the MORE for compensation schemes. At times there could be some red tape or some bureaucracy that will happen along the way. There should also be proactive OSHA inspection program, because in Abu Dhabi, for example, we have the OSHA who regulates the safety practitioners, and they do have the sector regulatory authorities do conduct OSHA inspection and audits, but do they document it? Do they implement the action plans and the corrective actions? Do they correct it? What's the follow-up? We don't have data for that, and it's not available public. And most importantly, this the last two. We need to improve the capacity and competence of our occupational health services here in the country. We can benchmark from, we usually benchmark from other countries when we send our samples to other countries. It will be better to, more cost-effective to have it here and to have more competent people to do it here, to do the analysis of the biological metabolites here. And most importantly, we have to have our workers involved in the formulation, supervision, and implementation of the disease, occupational disease prevention. For example, in for participatory ergonomics, the workers itself know how to solve the problem and what proper design to do for the workstation to be able to avoid any musculoskeletal discomfort in the future. I think we need to go through that, and we need to be more proactive and involve our workers in it. So that's all I have to say. If you have any questions, you can reach me here. And thank you very much for the opportunity to deliver the talk. Thank you.
Mr. Ang, and thank you to our resource persons, Dr. Ho, Dr. Joseph, and Dr. Ang, Mr. Ang, for your presentations. We will now proceed immediately with answering questions relayed by the audience. May I please request all of our resource persons to turn on your video camera and keep it on so that we can spotlight you all during the question and answer. All right, so thank you very much. So let's proceed with the first question.
Can you let me turn on my video camera?
Yes, please, Ms. Dr. Ho, you can turn on your camera.
Yeah, I cannot. You cannot start your video because if the host has stopped it.
Right. Okay,
I came in again. All right.
Okay. Can you please try again now, Ms. Dr. Ho? It's already on.
All right, great. It's here.
Okay.
Can you see me?
All right. Okay. Yes, we can see you. Thank you, Dr. Ho. All right. Great. So actually, the first question is addressed to you, Dr. Ho.
Yeah. So maybe we unshare first so we can have a bigger screen. Thank you.
All right. Okay. Thank you. All right.
Thank you.
So, okay. All right. So the first question is addressed to you, Dr. Ho. The question from our participant, bullying is now developing and even common in the social media. Can you please share some strategies on how to address this in the school or university setting?
Basically, I think we should have a what we call a standard operating procedure on anything related to risk factor, especially bullying. And bullying, and not just bullying, but basically any psychosocial stress that is faced in the workplace. Because bullying is one of the psychosocial stress. And there's in our university, basically we have a psychological services that actually allow us to the students and also the academics to actually go and get psychological support. And getting the psychological support, it would be confidential for the people to understand psychological support. But of course, you're talking about bullying per se from your work, from your colleague or from your superior, then there should be a system in place where you can actually report bullying that to the higher authority or to your supervisor or your occupational safety and health practitioner. But we have basically in Malaysia, we have what we call the OSH representative by the employee. So this is similar to what ILO basically have promoted, is basically the bipartite or tripartite arrangement, where bipartite means between the employer and employee, and tripartite means between employer, employee, and the government. So those are the things that we have in place. I think that's how we need to move forward.
All right. Thank you very much, Dr. Ho, for sharing your answer to the participant's question. The next question is actually for Dr. Joseph, because this is also related somehow to the question that was posed to Dr. Victor Ho. So the question is, how do we shift from reactionary treatment, which is common in Philippine setting, to preventive approach in terms of occupational health in the workplace? Dr. Joseph, please.
Great. Thank you, Dr. Estrada. For me, it's very important that the leadership or the occupational health and safety personnel would establish the credibility and the highest level of reputation in the field, because persuasion is very important. And on top of that, the doctor or the nurse who is leading the OHS program or health promotion program should show everything that he or she has in place in line with the compliance of the government requirements. As I mentioned in my presentation, the 8-hour mandatory training is very, very helpful and impactful for the government. And part of that, by the way, of the training course is the penal provisions of the DOLE. So with that, this is a part of my presentation in my course. And I saw the reaction of the management when they saw about 10 or thousands of pesos per day per activity that is missed as a compliance. So I think I thought that would be very helpful. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Joseph. So still on the topic of psychosocial hazards, this question is addressed to Mr. Ang. Mr. Ang, our participant, is asking, did I hear it correctly that you mentioned some employees who received their compensations late resorted to suicide? What is being done to address this, and what is the liability of the employer?
Well, that's why we have a psychosocial hazard management. We have the policy, which is trickled down to the particular subject matter expert who will trickle it down to the sites. There's a policy available. There's also the employee wellness initiative. There's a hotline that we have. Like, for example, the contractors can call this confidential hotline to discuss their problems. I mean, we try to make it as much visible and available as we can. We also do prevention audits with regard to the group companies who have these cases. That's what I can say about that. But for liability of the employer, because majority of the suicides occur from the contractor's perspective. So what would be the involvement here would be the group, the company which manages these contractor employees would be liable and would be they would work hand in hand with the police for that particular emirate on how they will handle the case. Normally, they would make a decision whether, on the compensation for the particular and benefits for the particular employee who passed away. So it's devolved more into the particular contractor company, but it's also trickled down to our organization on how we can do better to manage employees who commit such. So does that answer the question, hopefully?
All right. Yes, sir. Thank you very much for addressing the question from our participant, Sir Ang. We circle back to Dr. Victor Ho. Dr. Victor Ho, we have a question here inquiring if Malaysia has resumed to face-to-face classes and work, because in the Philippines, some universities have hybrid classes. Some have online classes, some have face-to-face. What are your thoughts on the hybrid mode of learning?
Basically, Malaysia and everything that moves back to face-to-face. And I think the hybrid mode of learning is good. But at the end is the educator must decide that why do you want the student to come to class? What's the reason for the student to come to class? So there should be some benefit for the student to come to class. Like, coming to class means you have face-to-face, you have discussion, you have exercise, you have hands-on activities. And if the thing can be done basically by doing face-to-face, by doing online, like what we are doing now, so what is the reason for me to come to class? The same thing. What's the reason for me to come to Philippines now? The reason I want to come to Philippines now is because maybe I want to talk to you directly, but the thing can be done online already. So what else can I do on to Philippines? Most of the time I come here just to visit your memorial or your places. But unless you have that, then hybrid class would be good, because that it allowed people to actually study when they can study. But the problem is hybrid class, as we understand, especially in countries with poor internet connection, with poor infrastructure, a lot of students are struggling. That's why in Malaysia, the reason why we started the face-to-face classes is that because our infrastructure is some of infrastructure in some of the places cannot cope with the student cannot cope. The student cannot get connected. And that student don't have the facilities to get connected. That's why we come back to face-to-face classes. We ask people to come back to face-to-face classes. Other than that, hybrid classes, I prefer hybrid classes.
All right. Thank you very much, Dr. Ho, for sharing your thoughts on hybrid classes. All right. So in the interest of time, we will be selecting the last two questions for our question and answer forum, question and answer part. So the next question is addressed to Dr. Joseph. Dr. Joseph, our participant is asking, how can we encourage our management for those promising programs about safety and health? We do presentations and all, but in the end, the company needed the budget on much more urgent things. It's like safety and health are really not valued in some companies, especially ours.
Thank you for that question, Dr. Estrada. It's very important to come up with the return of investments as a planner for OHS program and for implementation of that. As part of the concept, you have to already have a projected outcome of what do you want to gain from the particular program. Of course, there are hard and soft returns of investments there. That I remember in an early department, I had a chance to teach this to the students, and the soft revenues could be equated with, for example, the lost time of the employees when they are injured or got ill of certain work-related injuries and illnesses. And also, we can also have a impute like the absenteeism, the cost of absenteeism that is due to OHS illnesses and injuries. And very important also to come up with figures, especially for companies which deal with numbers. Semiconductor is one, and of course, the call center or the contact center of the Philippines are very mindful of coming up with statistics and actual figures of returns of engagement, and prove your worth to management that you can do it. Leadership is very important. Thank you very much.
All right. Thank you very much, Dr. Joseph, also for emphasizing on the leadership, for the need for leadership. Dr. PM also shared this in the webinar, in our chat, that we really need to do a systems approach, because for any changes in the OHS programs and services to be implemented, we need to focus on the system elements, starting with leadership. So thank you very much, Dr. Joseph, also for sharing your thoughts on this question. Dr. Ho, I'm sorry, I need to follow up another point on your answer that was that you shared earlier. We have a follow-up question. So Dr. Ho, in universities, were the students included in the OSH management program, or was it only the workers that are covered? Thank you.
In UC Malaya, basically, we have, especially in Faculty of Medicine, we have actually asked the, even in other faculty, the representative from the student as one of the members of our OSH committee. So the students are involved in the OSH committee. And we ask them to bring forward any of their grievances or any issues that related to OSH in that. So that basically they have a voice there. So the student have a voice. And of course, the student also have a voice in the Senate itself. So in the Senate, we also invite students to join the Senate. Senate is the upper management of the university, where the student actually, if they have occupational safety and health issue, they can actually voice it out. The problem is that most of the students are not clear or not well versed with what are occupational safety issue, what are their rights, how they come from. Because we want to focus on safety and health issue, not focus on other more emotional and more other issues. So we do have them, and we allow them to basically voice out their opinion and voice out their grievances and provide suggestions. Thank you.
All right. Thank you very much, Dr. Ho. To wrap up our open forum, our open discussion, I would also like to share a comment from one of our participants on Mr. Buford Ang's presentation. So the participant said, I like the emphasis on wages that can be a root cause for psychosocial issues. Hopefully, salaries of OSH practitioners in the Philippines will be reviewed and calibrated, not only comparing among Philippine companies, but also considering overseas by the employers. So I also like the 3 full-time dedicated OSH practitioners as minimum requirement for companies. The word dedicated makes a difference from the Philippines. So thank you very much to our panelists for answering the questions from our participants this morning. Thank you very much for the fruitful discussion. And we would like to thank you again, Dr. Ho, Dr. Joseph, and Mr. Ang. And we would like to award the certificates of appreciation for sharing your time and your expertise with us this morning. Please allow me to read the certificate. The certificate reads, College of Public Health, University of the Philippines, Manila, Simiotropmed Regional Center for Public Health, Hospital Administration, Environmental and Occupational Health, awards the certificate of appreciation to our esteemed speakers for their invaluable contribution by sharing their expertise as resource person during the 5th National Environmental and Occupational Health Forum conducted by the Department of Environmental and Occupational Health, done remotely from the College of Public Health, University of the Philippines, Manila, on November 25, 2022. Given this 25th day of November in the year 2022 in the city of Manila, Philippines. Signed, Professor Gaylin F. Manalang Jr., Organizing Committee Chair of the 5th EOH Forum. Yours truly, Department Chair and Overall Coordinator, Dr. T.J. Robinson Moncatar, Assistant to the Dean for Planning and Development, and Dr. Fernando B. Garcia Jr., Dean and Center Director. So the College of Public Health, Senior Regional Center of Public Health, Hospital Administration, and Environmental and Occupational Health awards the Certificate of Appreciation to Dr. Victor Ho of the University of Malaya. We also would like the College of Public Health, Senior Regional Center of Public Health, Hospital Administration, and Environmental and Occupational Health awards the Certificate of Appreciation also to Dr. Renato Joseph of Walls in Motion Incorporated. And last but definitely not the least, the College of Public Health, Simiotropmed Regional Center of Public Health, Hospital Administration, and Environmental and Occupational Health awards the Certificate of Appreciation to Mr. Buford. Right, so thank you very much to our excellent speakers this morning. Let us conclude the panel discussion with a photo opportunity. And with this, we would like to request our organizers and speakers to please turn on your cameras to document this significant event. So I would like to request our screen manager to guide us when taking the photos.
Hey, Dr. Estrada. I'd like to reiterate the request to please turn your cameras to our panelists and faculty. Okay po, on the count of 3, please show us your best smile. 1. Teka, may mga naka-close po.
We cannot turn on our videos.
Okay po, sir. Thank you, sir. 1, 2, 3. Sa pa po. 1, 2, 3.
Sir Dexter, apologies. Can we check if all the panelists have access to turning on their cameras?
Yes, ma'am. We can see Sir Ang, Professor. Okay po.
Thank you.
Once more po. Please smile.
Hi, Prof.
3. Thank you. Dana po.
Right. Thank you very much, Sir Dexter. You may now turn off your cameras and please join us in spreading our advocacy through this event. All of our participants, may we please request you to post a selfie while you are attending this forum and please use the hashtags hashtag 50OH forum, hashtag SDG, and hashtag WeRCPH. As with yesterday, may we please request you to accomplish the evaluation forms and your responses will be considered in planning our next offering. Okay, so our the link for the day 2 evaluation form will be shared by our staff later through Zoom chat, our YouTube live chat, and EOH Forum Google site. Our viewers here in Zoom or in YouTube live stream will all receive their certificates of attendance by accomplishing the said evaluation forms. And this will also be emailed to the registrants immediately after the event. You are allowed to accomplish these forms until 4 p.m. of the day. So this concludes our second panel discussion, Best Practices for the Post-Pandemic Non-Healthcare Workplace. So we will now have our wellness break. Our program will resume at 11 a.m. So this has been your moderator, Crystal Estrada. Thank you.
Good morning again, everyone. Our program will resume at 11 a.m. Thank you. Good morning and welcome back, everyone. I am again Dr. PM Hernandez of the Department of Environmental and Occupational Health, College of Public Health, UP Manila, and I am returning as your MC for day two of the fifth Environmental and Occupational Health Forum. This year's Environmental and Occupational Health Forum is made extra special as we share with you today the commemoration of the signing of the renewed partnership between the University of the Philippines, Manila, and Healthcare Without Harm, Southeast Asia. Before we proceed with the program, please allow me to recognize some of our guests in the audience. Dr. Marilu Renales, former DEOH faculty and presently consultant of Hidena Corporation. Dr. Monrey Mancilla, Department of Health Center for Health Development, Bicol. Dr. Vivian Cespenye, DOHCHD Soc-Sergeant, Coronadal City. Ms. Chloe Jean Mojica, DOH Lecturer and MOH Program Alumna. Dr. Edmir Macabulos, former President of the Philippine College of Occupational Medicine. Dr. Rowena Blanco Santos, former president of the Philippine College of Occupational Medicine, Quezon City Chapter. Ms. Maria Leslie Olmido, World Health Organization Western Pacific Region Consultant. Engineer Luis Cruz, Supervising Health Program Officer, Department of Health, Philippines Central Office. Officers and members of the regional OSH network for regions 10, 11, and 12. DOHCHD of the Cordillera Administrative Region, Environmental and Occupational Health Team. Officers and members of the Philippine Society for Safety Professionals, as led by Mr. Christopher Madriaga, its incumbent president. So again, welcome to the fifth Environmental and Occupational Health Forum, and we do hope to see you in our future events and collaborations. So what are we celebrating right now? What is this collaboration about? Let me give a brief introduction. The partnership agreement between UP Manila and Healthcare Without Harm Southeast Asia was renewed only this month, November 2022, through the efforts of the Department of Environmental and Occupational Health. This five-year partnership agreement will further strengthen the implementation of joint activities of the two institutions, particularly in teaching, research, and public service, with focus on climate change and health. As part of this commemoration activity, we will revisit the main accomplishments of this collaboration from 2019 to 2022. The presentation will be delivered by no less than our Chair of the Department of Environmental and Occupational Health, Dr. Cristal Emil M. Estrada. We will likewise hear messages from the College of Public Health Dean, Dr. Fernando B. Garcia Jr., UP Manila Chancellor Carmencita Padilla, and Healthcare Without Harm Southeast Asia Executive Director, Mr. Ramon San Pascual. At this point, please let me turn over the virtual floor to Dr. Fernando B. Garcia Jr., Dean of the College of Public Health and Center Director, Simeotropmed Philippines, for the opening remarks. Over to you, Dean Jun.
Great. Thank you, Dr. PM. Can you hear me?
Loud and clear, Dean.
Okay, salamat. To Mr. Ramon San Pascual, the Executive Director of Healthcare Without Harm Southeast Asia. To Dr. Carmencita D. Padilla, our dear Chancellor from the University of the Philippines, Manila. To Dr. Cristal Emiel M. Estrada, the Chair of the Department of Environmental and Occupational Health of the College of Public Health, Manila. Sa mga kasamahan kong faculty, reps, and staff of the College of Public Health, to our distinguished guests and participants in this forum, good morning once again. On behalf of the College of Public Health, also designated as the Simeotropmed Philippines Regional Center for Public Health, Hospital Administration, Environmental and Occupational Health, we are pleased to welcome you all to this commemorative partnership with Healthcare Without Harm Southeast Asia. For many years now, Healthcare Without Harm has been at the forefront of environmental health advocacy and ensuring that healthcare services are delivered effectively while minimizing environmental waste. Such a noble cause for an organization, and a big shout for this organization. With public health issues like climate change and poor water, sanitation and hygiene leading to an increased incidence of communicable and non-communicable diseases, we cannot overstate the impact that environmental degradation has on increasing the incidence of poor health outcomes, not only in the Philippines, but also in the East Asia Pacific region and around the world. As such, my deepest gratitude goes to the team at Healthcare Without Harm, led by Mr. Ramon San Pascual, the Executive Director of this organization, for engaging with us in this partnership. Thank you as well to all the members of the Department of Environmental and Occupational Health for their contribution in making this collaboration possible. We look forward to a collaborative and fruitful partnership with Healthcare Without Harm in providing training, conducting research, and organizing public service initiatives that contribute towards the protection of the environment and the well-being of our workers, both within and beyond the health sector. Muli, marami pong salamat at isang mapagpalang umaga sa ating lahat. Back to you, Doc PM.
Thank you, Dean Garcia. Heart-react naman tayo dyan. Now let me call on Dr. Cristal Emil M. Estrada, Chair of the Department of Environmental and Occupational Health, College of Public Health, University of the Philippines, Manila, to talk about the accomplishments from the previous partnership agreement and the exciting plans for the next 5 years. Over to you, Doctal.
Right. Thank you very much po, Dr. PM, for sharing for the introduction. I'm seeing a lot of heart reactions. No? Nakikita ko po sa gilid lumalabas ng screen ang mga heart reactions, and we're very happy also for the renewal of our partnership with Healthcare Without Harm. And of course, we would like to also present our accomplishments for our previous partnership for the past 3 years. So please allow me to share my screen to briefly share our the milestones of the partnership between UP College of Public Health and DEO and Healthcare Without Harm. May I confirm if you can see my screen?
Yes, Doctal.
Thank you very much, Dr. PM. So good morning again to all our distinguished guests, our attendees, and of course, our partners from Healthcare Without Harm Southeast Asia, led by Executive Director Mr. Ramon San Pascual. We are very honored to present the accomplishments and of course, our plans, our ways forward for the partnership between UP College of Public Health, Department of Environmental and Occupational Health, and Healthcare Without Harm Southeast Asia. So as a brief background, as shared by Dr. PM Hernandez earlier, the partnership between UPCTH, DEO, and Healthcare Without Harm started in 2019. And since then, we have organized several activities. First of these activities is the media launch and the public forum on plastics waste management in June 2019. So this activity aimed to contribute to the mitigation of plastic pollution and to emphasize the crucial role of our healthcare community in protecting the health of our people and the environment. Also part of this activity was the signing of a memorandum of understanding to minimize the use of plastics in hospitals. And this was signed by Healthcare Without Harm Executive Director Sir Mon San Pascual and our UP Manila College of Public Health Dean during that time, Dean Romeo Quizon, who is also a member of our department. Aside from our forum on plastics waste management, we also had, in partnership with Healthcare Without Harm Southeast Asia, a public forum entitled Understanding Air Pollution, Its Link to the Climate Crisis, Impact on Human Health, and the Role of the Healthcare Sector. This was held exactly 4 years ago, no? On November 25, 2019. So sorry, that was 3 years ago, no? Which included discussions on the Healthy Air Now campaign, the Philippine Situationer on air pollution, health impacts of air pollution, and the UPCPH initiatives on air pollution, and the role of the healthcare sector in the fight against air pollution, and also included some reactions from the various government and non-government institutions. The College of Public Health, Department of Environmental and Occupational Health faculty members are also members of the RISE Southeast Asia Alliance for Health and Climate. This was launched in November 2020, which aims to build a competent, inclusive alliance of healthcare leaders to advance climate action, health equity, resilience, and a healthy recovery in Southeast Asia in the context of increasing climate change risk and the COVID-19 pandemic in the region. Healthcare Without Harm Southeast Asia also developed and launched a climate and health communications and advocacy toolkit for health professionals and climate justice advocates, in which the College of Public Health participated in the development of the toolkit and its launch last October 2021. So as we can see here, the photo of the virtual launch of the toolkit where College of Public Health also participated. Healthcare Without Harm Southeast Asia also frequently participates in events organized by UPCTH and DEO, such as serving as a speaker at the 4th Environmental and Occupational Health Forum held last year, November 25 to 2026. Sir Mon San Pascual served as one of our session speakers during the 4th EOH Forum. Sir Mon also served as a reactor for the UPCPH and British Embassy Manila organized webinar entitled Protecting Health Amid Environmental Impacts of Climate Change in the Now Normal. This webinar is part of the series webinar series entitled Public Health in the Time of COVID-19 and the Now Normal. British Embassy Manila UP College of Public Health webinar series for public health workers. This webinar was held last February 24, 2020. So these are some of the major milestones of our partnership with Healthcare Without Harm Southeast Asia. And we are very proud and honored to share with everyone that we have renewed the partnership between UPCPH and Healthcare Without Harm Southeast Asia. And we're looking forward to these future activities. So moving forward, as we embark on a new phase of our partnership, we have more exciting activities in the pipeline. Healthcare Without Harm Southeast Asia will participate in selected UPCPH course offerings, both graduate and undergraduate, especially now that we are working on Mr. San Pascual joining the Day of Faculty roster as our adjunct faculty. The partnership will also open more possibilities for joint research activities on climate change, disasters, and health, and also the creation of joint trainings and conferences in the future. We're also honored to announce that the 6th Environmental and Occupational Health Forum that will be held next year on November 23 and 24, 2023, will be co-organized by UPCPH, Department of Environmental and Occupational Health, and Healthcare Without Harm Southeast Asia. We look forward to these activities and learning opportunities in the next 5 years that will contribute to our goal of defending people's health from plastic and air pollution, unsustainable medical waste management, and other adverse causes and impacts of climate change. So with that, thank you very much, and we look forward to these activities. Thank you very much, and over to you again, Dr. Yev.
Thank you, Dr. Cal, for the recap of the activities and the partnerships that we've had with Healthcare Without Harm Southeast Asia. And I noted the upcoming ones, although a bit of the broad strokes, but really excited, particularly our partnership for the next EOH forum and the teaching activities that we had. So excited ako dun sa courses. Thank you, Dr. Cal, for that presentation. Let us now listen to Dr. Carmencita D. Padilla, Chancellor, University of the Philippines, Manila, for her message.
The College of Public Health's Department of Environmental and Occupational Health on the commemoration of its partnership with Healthcare Without Harm Southeast Asia. UP Manila is honored and privileged to be a strategic collaborator of this organization in helping achieve environmentally caring, workplace healthy, and resilient communities. Working with you through the years has made us hopeful and confident that nothing is impossible, even the task of abating complex public health problems. Dynamic cooperation with the organizations working on the ground are a big boost in the fight against environmental and occupational risk and hazards. Healthcare Without Harm Southeast Asia has been inspiring us in this crusade through its firm commitment and ingenuity, thus the sustenance of this alliance. In our setting, this holds much weight as the Philippines has been experiencing one crisis after another, one calamity every so often that adds stress on the healthcare. The protracted coronavirus, regular typhoons, outbreak of other infections, volcanic eruptions, and other disasters challenge our preparedness, response, and recovery efforts. Rebuilding and reinforcing systems in the aftermath of environmental and occupational calamities entail time and multisectoral integrated efforts. We are therefore grateful for our association with the Healthcare Without Harm Southeast Asia. It has survived time and challenges because of our devotion to our shared goal of providing health care that is not harmful but beneficial to the people who need the most. This partnership is at the core of our mission as the leading university works towards the fulfillment of the Filipinos' optimal health and well-being. Congratulations, College of Public Health and Healthcare Without Harm Southeast Asia for this enduring cooperation. Maraming salamat at mabuhay.
Thank you, Chancellor Carmen Zita Di Padilla, for your message. And I do agree with emphasizing the need for multisectoral and sustained collaborations in addressing important public health issues. And we're very fortunate that Healthcare Without Harm Southeast Asia chose to continue this partnership. So let us now hear from our partner, Healthcare Without Harm Southeast Asia, through its executive director, Mr. Ramon San Pascual. Over to you, Sir Ramon.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Dr. PM. How we miss you. How I wish I'll be able to see you in person once again very soon, but I just wish a warm greetings on this kind of anniversary celebration and rekindling of our partnership. Our Chancellor, thank you so much for your warm message welcoming the challenge that we will need to confront over the next 5 years through the partnership of the UP College of Public Health and the Healthcare Without Harm. Thank you so much, Dr. Fernando Garcia, our dean. And of course, I regularly communicate with Dr. Crystal Strada, our director in the DOH. And to so many of you, our colleagues in public health and environmental health work in the country, good morning. And to all the students and the members of the faculty, magandang umaga po. We're grateful for this ceremony. It may be online, but by looking into the review that was presented a while ago, most of it was done when we signed in 2019 the first agreement. We didn't know that there will be a global pandemic that is about to come. So a large part of that covered portion of the agreement happened while we are going through the difficult time of the COVID pandemic. And yet, if you look into how we started, for example, on plastics pollution and how it impacts hospitals and healthcare, look where we are now. In few days' time, there will be the first ever treaty negotiation on plastics being done at the level of the United Nations. And this will be in Uruguay. And we do hope that countries similar to how we came to an agreement on climate decades ago will also come to an agreement to eliminate harmful single-use plastic and reduce its production in 2 years' time from the negotiation point that will take place a week from now. And I'm even happy to share to you that our own colleague, whom you have met several times, Mr. Paeng Lopez, will be part of the delegation of the Healthcare Without Harm and the Break Free from Plastic, and will carry all the partnership that we have, including with the College of Public Health, when she joins in person that negotiation as an NGO observer. At the same time, be able to influence our delegates so as to address the plastic in the context of climate change, in the context of the toxic emission being contributed by unnecessary use of plastic. So that is one achievement that I could already charge against the partnership that we have. We are part of a large movement addressing plastics in healthcare, and that's how we started. And then recently, we also concluded the COP27 in Egypt. And one of our colleagues who've been very active engaging with this partnership with the DOH and the College of Public Health is Jit Sohal, who happens to be with the DOH event now in Iloilo on greening of hospitals, gathering all the DOH healthcare facilities there. But she was also part of the delegation that attended the COP27, and they came back just a few days ago. And by reviewing what has been achieved, and the core of our partnership, as being reiterated now, in the paper that in the agreement that I signed more than a week ago, it was brought to our office, and then I signed it right then and there, such that a counter signature can also be done in time for this celebration. A big part of that agreement is on climate and health. The biggest challenge that we still need to confront and do our work now, both as you as an academic institution and us as an international NGO working with the healthcare sector, with healthcare professionals, with healthcare academe. Just to share to you what has been achieved, because this has been assessed quickly by our delegation in Egypt during the COP27. Again, considering the broad partnership that we have with different organizations and a strategic partnership at that, just like our own 5-year partnership now that we just signed up again with the College of Public Health. One, that we are able to advance the climate strategy in the areas of work through our presence at the COP, and that we are able to coordinate across global network, while specifically moving healthcare to Race to Zero, resilience, climate, and health justice work forward. Two, by the presence of Healthcare Without Harm in so many other groups, again, bringing into forefront the partnerships that we collaborate with, that we do with different national organizations, again, including, I will always highlight our own partnership, we were able to contribute and continue to play a leadership role in supporting and building a global climate and health movement while networking and building new relationships with those who can help scale the work in continuously growing our field of activism, our field of movement, growth in climate and health. Now, if you read the reports and the news coming up from Egypt in the aftermath of the COP27, on one hand, there was the fund created to mitigate the harsh impact of climate in small and developing countries in terms of loss and damage, which is a win in itself. However, there is also a huge gap in terms of the commitment on 1.5. And this is where the contention is still continue. And we will have another COP in a year to come. And yet we are starting our new agreement, our new partnership, a small step in a large field where the future of our humanity is at stake. So that's where I appreciate the work that we're doing. And I'm even humbled by the fact that at the beginning of this semester, I also played a new role now as part of the adjunct faculty of the DEOH. So I can speak both as Healthcare Without Harm in a way, and also as part of the faculty in the department. And I'm blessed and humbled by this opportunity. In fact, this morning as I was reviewing what is to happen during the ceremony, I was also reviewing some of the papers that were already submitted to me when I first did a lecture on climate and health. A simple plan, an action plan that is to be done by the students in the college. And I'm fascinated by the commitment, by the depth of appreciation, and by the desire to make change, even when these are still young people doing their studies in public health and medical field. So I'm grateful. I'm looking into the role that we will play, the duties and responsibilities of the Healthcare Without Harm Southeast Asia in the next years to put life into our partnership. And I pledge this once more. I just did not sign it for the sake of formal documentation, but we will, and I have my colleagues watching and documenting as well, and I'm sure it will also come out in our own social media outlets in a while, but we are committing to share resources on climate and health. We are far richer now than when we started in 2019 in terms of the knowledge, resources, networks, and even that desire to make impact. And these resources on climate and health, whether guidance document, case studies, tools, manuals, will be made available to our students. Second, to develop, and this is how I wish we can start this, to co-develop short courses for extension and public health services. We are a small office. You may think of partnering with a 10 people secretariat in the Southeast Asia Office of Healthcare Without Harm. But the broad network that we are part of, including the creation of RISE, where some of the faculty are also part of, and the broadening GGHH, make it a rich network where you are now a part of. So we hope to co-develop that short course to integrate climate change and health courses in both undergraduate and graduate programs. We are committing to this as well. And even to become resource persons or tap our other pool of experts to be your resource persons, national, regional, or international, we can tap them to even become your lecturer, whether on the area of resilient and climate smart healthcare, on advocacy itself, on procurement, on green healthcare, in plastics, and even on communications, and so on and so forth. But these three or four things that our core commitment to you in the course of carrying out our partnership, and we can already see that we're on the late stage of the pandemic. We can again meet person to person and do activities together in person. Let's have it started now. And then finally, we also would want you to see the work that we do, not only in the Philippines, but regionally and globally as well. In fact, I would wish that through this partnership, the UP Public Health College, the DOH, will be present in the next GHAC, or what we call as the Green Hospital Asia Conference, that will take place on February 1, 2, and 3 in Pondicherry in India. Take your case and take your best practices there. We will make you a resource in several of the small discussions and plenary discussions that will happen in the course of that conference. We can discuss this further, but we would like to highlight our partnership and proudly declare it across the community of environmental health and public health practitioners, hospital leaders, Ministry of Health people, and global community that will be present during that event on February 1, 2, and 3. So this is a formal invitation that I'm extending to give life onto our partnership, and let us see how we can work out the mechanics. So I'm really happy today. I can see that this is part of the extension of my birthday. I celebrated my birthday yesterday, but as if I'm celebrating again, just being part of this ceremony. So on behalf of our board, our chairperson, his secretary Cabral, and the rest of the members of the board, on behalf of the staff, and even our global colleagues in Healthcare Without Harm, thank you so much for the opportunity. And let's get on to our work beginning today. Thank you.
Thank you, Sir Mon San Pascual. Belated happy birthday. Belated happy birthday. We'll see you in our courses as an adjunct faculty, and we're excited for a favorable outcome during the negotiations to eliminate harmful single-use plastics barriers. So we also look forward in expanding our advocacy groups, and nabanggit naman ni Sir Mon, particularly RISE and GGHH. So should anyone from the audience be interested to join our advocacy groups, please reach out to us. So this concludes our commemoration activity. We would like to thank all of you for joining us in this historic event. Okay, can we request for a photo?
Sir Mayor, request everyone to please turn on your camera. Thank you. Count of three. Smile po. 1, 2, 3. Dana po. Thank you.
Thank you, Sir Dex. So,
thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Sir Mon. Thank you, Dean Garcia. So let's now proceed directly with our concluding session. So we just ended the commemorative activity of the partnership agreement of between UP Manila through the Department of Environmental and Occupational Health and Healthcare Without Harm Southeast Asia. We are equally excited in joining the activities and the future collaborations, particularly in India. Okay, so makapwede tayong sumali doon. We would also like to again express our sincerest gratitude to all our speakers today, Professor Victor Ho of Malaysia, Dr. Renato Yosef from the Philippines, and Mr. Buford Ang from the United Arab Emirates. Thank you again to Sir Mon San Pascual and colleagues from Healthcare Without Harm Southeast Asia as our advocacy partners. We value your feedback, so please accomplish the evaluation form. The link will be shared by our staff. For the audience to receive their certificates of attendance, kindly ensure that you accomplish the evaluation forms, both for days 1 and 2. The link for the day 2 evaluation form will be shared by our staff. These will also be emailed to the registrants immediately after this event. You are allowed to accomplish the form for day 2 until 4 p.m. this afternoon, of course, Philippine Standard Time. Kindly take note that the materials presented by our resource persons will be downloadable via an official Google folder, which will be shared at the end of the forum through email and through our Google site. The folder will be accessible until November 23, 2023. So that will be until next year. To officially conclude our two-day forum, I would like to invite the organizing committee chair of this event, Professor Gaylene F. Manalang Jr., for her closing remarks. Professor Gaylene F. Manalang Jr. is an alumna of the BS Physical Therapy and Master of Occupational Health Programs, University of the Philippines, Manila. She also obtained her International Health and Safety Qualifications from the University of Illinois at Chicago, USA, International Program in Occupational Health Practice, and from NIBOSH, UK, International General Certificate in Occupational Health and Safety. As a physical therapist, she has been engaged as clinician retainer at the company clinic of a large-scale multinational company. She is also an ergonomics specialist for projects for enhancing physical ergonomics. Moreover, she has contributed to various health and safety initiatives among government institutions such as the Mariano Marcos Memorial Hospital and Medical Center in Ilocos Norte, Land Bank, and the Philippine Heart Center. Professor Manalang is best known for her work on body clock types or chronotypes, publishing the first scientific studies on Filipino chronotypes with the PhilShift Research Group. For her pursuits as a Filipino physical therapist, occupational health educator, and human chronobiology researcher, Professor Manalang is recognized by the Professional Regulation Commission of the Philippines as the 2017 Most Outstanding Professional in the Field of Physical Therapy. She teaches graduate and undergraduate programs in occupational health and public health. In the past year, coordinating courses on ethics for public health professionals, occupational health and safety systems, industrial safety, and ergonomics. Let's all welcome Professor Galen Manalang. Over to you, Ma'am Galen.
Thank you, Dr. Hernandez, and greetings to all of you, wherever you may be in the world right now, and of course, even those who will play back this video long after this event. I would like to express my gratitude to all here who made the fifth EOH forum possible. Our Chancellor, Dr. Padilla, our College Dean, Dr. Garcia, who joined us for both days, our Department Chair, of course, Dr. Estrada, and our immediate past chair, Dr. Hernandez. Okay. I'm grateful to our dedicated department staff, Sirs John, Ian, and Dex, as well as Moms May, Heidi, and Chester for all their hard work, as well as all the input and participation of my fellow department faculty, Professor Enobeso Duarte, Dr. Fadrilan Camacho, Mr. Domingo, Professor Lomboy, Dr. Molina, and former Dean Quizon. Okay. Of course, I am grateful very much from the bottom of my heart to our esteemed speakers who did not hesitate to accept the invitation to be part of the forum for us opening lecturer and panel discussants, Dr. Okayasu, Engineer Ho, Mr. Arjona, Dr. Cucueco, Professor Ho, Dr. Joseph, and Mr. Ang. Okay. I'd like to say a most special expression of gratitude to all the participants of this forum. Thank you for signaling with your webinar and YouTube presence that we have prepared a worthwhile formative activity, an activity that will bring us past this pandemic and moreover, further our environmental and occupational health practice. What a time it is to be in the environmental and occupational health professions. We were all suddenly set to address one common threat. And from this, environmental and occupational health came into mainstream consciousness. So that nowadays, when people say environment, health, and safety, we know that they appreciate us more. And our practices are not that obscure anymore to them. Let us take advantage of this new consciousness about environmental occupational health as a field and as a profession to use our talents to take care of people and our finite resources to promote sustainability, which is basically promoting the good of all. We in the EOH professions are in a community of practice that work in diverse situations and even geographic locations. When I was preparing this forum, I sought to deliberately highlight this diaspora and engage as many of us in our societies and even as individual practitioners as possible. So thank you for helping achieve that goal. Okay. Let us all support each other and make use of the technology that is available to us to keep up our conversations on environmental and occupational health. So where do we go from here? I would like to pay tribute to the past EOH fora and sensitize you to the next things that will happen by using the themes of these past fora. In the first EOH forum, we identified challenges and opportunities in environmental and occupational health. So many have opened for us in the recent years, so that now, as the second forum told us before, we need to bridge the gap. Okay? And in bridging the gap, we would like to realize sustainable development. To do this, the third forum advised that we would need consensus, collaboration, and capacity building. Okay? Whatever role we play in this diaspora, be it being a consensus facilitator, all levels of a collaborator, or a capacity builder, we should aim to build back better as the fourth forum advised us, so that when the next crisis comes upon us, it does not bring us to our knees, or at least we are able to get back up quickly. Okay? We do not know when the next global crisis will come upon us, but we do know that it will happen. And when it does, we hope that by that time, we have more healthy workplaces. Thank you again for attending this year's EOH Forum, where we sought to hear exactly about this. Okay. We are grateful for your understanding of the limited venue, as well as all your expressions of what we need to do and what more we need to discuss. You have been heard not only by the committee, but by our resource persons and by your fellow environmental and occupational health professionals. Your feedback to us will be taken forward by us, because we see ourselves as facilitators of collaboration. Okay. We will bring forward the feedback that we have received over the past 2 days in our future events. And speaking of future events, it is time to invite you to save the date of the next EOH forum. Okay. Our next Environmental and Occupational Health Forum will be on the 23rd and 24th of November, 2023. We are not yet sure if this is going to be an online event like this one or a face-to-face event, but I think the department is leaning to at least maintaining a component of it online so that we could all see each other and hopefully year after year, seeing each other again. Okay. Aside from this, to save the date for the 6th Environmental and Occupational Health Forum, we would like to confirm and also invite you to the next postgraduate course on occupational health and safety. This one is sure to be online in April. So it will be 10 days in April, 2023. Okay. Any inquiries about this, please do not hesitate to reach out to us via this email address. You may also follow our social media channels to keep up to date with the activities of the department. Thank you very much again. And this concludes the 5th Environmental and Occupational Health Forum. We hope to see you at our next events. Keep safe and God bless everyone.
Thank you, Professor Manalang. So we'll see everyone on November 23 and 24, 2023 for the next Environmental and Occupational Health Forum offering. Ingat po tayong palagi. Stay safe po. Bye-bye.
No.